You Want to Do, the show that will hopefully help you figure out what you want to do in life or reconnect you to what you love doing. Each show has a guest who is doing what they want to do, whether it's in their career or in addition to their regular job. Most importantly, we want to help you realize that no matter your age, you too can do what you want to do if you have the will to do it. Now here's your host, Leonard Kaplan.
Hi, and thanks for joining me here on What Do You Want to Do? Today's guest I've known since he was a teenager. His name is Jonathan Krell. He's a member of that group I always mentioned, the Cable Club from Swampscott, Mass. And he's a very creative person, and I'm dying to see what he's been doing. I've had hints of it, but let's go to part one right now. And welcome to another edition of What Do You Want to Do? My guest is Jonathan Krell, and I never thought I'd be saying that because you live so far away, and it's been so many years since I've seen you, John. How are you?
Doing great, Len. Thank you. I've missed hanging out with you up in the Boston area. I'm down in the Virginia area. But yes, those were the good old days back in high school.
You've been out so long away from this region, you almost forgot where you live for a second, didn't you?
Yes, it's been a while. Although it is in the 20s down here in Virginia today, so that is familiar.
Yeah, it was like 15 here. 15 degrees this morning. And but I managed to, you know, I love the cold. I'm kind of a weirdo that way, but that's a story for another time. So anyway, yeah. Welcome to What Do You Want to Do, John? And What Do You Want to Do is a show that features people who are doing what they want to do, either as a career or as a hobby or as a part-time thing. Or they might be just dreaming of it and getting ready to do it and don't know how to do it. And you fall in the category of you are doing it because you are a go-getter. You've always been a go-getter.
Thanks, Len.
I'm serious. He doesn't know if I'm serious, folks, but I'm serious. So, John, let's give the audience a little bit of your background and where you came from. And some of the things that you like to do aside from what we're going to talk about.
Well, thanks so much, Len. Thank you so much for having me. It's awesome to be here at your show. I just love your show and the theme of your show. I think it's great. I grew up in Swampscott, going to Swampscott High School, hanging out in the cable studio with Len Kaplan and all the other cable guys and girls over there in the cable room, and then off to college and came down to DC, became a lawyer, worked at a law firm for 6 years, and then moved on to work with the Children's Law Center in DC, which is a nonprofit that works with kids who are abused and neglected. And my job is to represent them and their best interests in court. And for me, this was like the dream job because it combined my interest in law with my interest in working with kids. Because back in the old days in Swampscott, I worked at the Salem YMCA. I was a camp counselor, worked at the Boston Children's Museum, did a lot of work with kids like in my prior life. And then this job allowed me to like combine my interest in the law and representing people who need a voice and working with kids, which I love doing. So I've been doing that for years and started my own like side legal practice, doing all kinds of guardian ad litem work, which is representing kids in like custody disputes, divorces, and things like that. You know, so I see a lot of difficult circumstances of abuse, neglect, divorce, conflict, and my job is to help kids kind of get through it all and turn the page, and start a new chapter that gets better and better, help families like heal, help parents get the services they need so there's no more abuse and neglect in the family, try to reunify them. And if that doesn't work out, also help out with adoption and things like that. And then on the side is, I've been doing some side hustles to try to make ends meet and reach some balance, you know, some balance in my life of all the sadness that I hear from my clients. And try to bring, you know, a little more joy into the world and into my life, and the, you know, my friends and family and stuff. So
This is very fascinating to me, because when you were hanging out with us after school and we did all these videos, we were doing comedy skits together.
Yes, we did some really good ones.
We really did. And in fact, I'm thinking of a day much like today up here. It was like 15 degrees. It was very cold. I don't know if you remember this.
Ancient artifacts. We did that mountain climbing skit,
and it was snowing. And it was just you and me outside. And it was like where the parking lot was. There was this big thing of rocks, and we made believe it was a mountain. And it looked like a mountain because the way I cropped the shot and you're climbing up that thing, it looked like you could have been in the Alps. You know, and that was a lot of fun. A lot of fun.
We had so much fun doing those skits and scenes in the cable room, in the school, in the parking lot.
Yeah.
We, you and me, and Joe Doulette and the whole gang. We just, it was just such a fun part of my childhood. I loved it so much. I gotta say, you and those guys in the cable club were so ahead. Ahead of the game, ahead of your time, before YouTube, you know, before iPhones, it was just, you know, it was like the joy and the excitement of video, you know.
I mean, I felt it too. I mean, that was the best part of my career, of all of my whole entire career. And I made like $5 an hour in that job. And when I ended that job, I made like $9.48 an hour in that job.
Right.
But doing the stuff with you guys, the comedy and the other creative shows that we did, that was the highlight of my existence, I have to say. It fulfilled a need, I guess, to express myself. Later on, it was, well, not later on, concurrently, I did Wrestling Talk as well. But anyway, we're going to get back to you. Now we know two sides, a very serious side, dealing with very serious issues. And we know you have a comedic side. So now I want to talk about, you are an inventor of sorts, are you not?
Well, yeah, I am. And it's this is the more crazy side. You know, when I was at the Boston Children's Museum, there's everyone up there in the Boston area knows about the Bubbles exhibit at the Boston Children's Museum, because we all went there. We all, like, as kids during field trips and, like, with family, would, like, you go to the Boston Children's Museum, you play in the Bubbles for, like, half an hour, and then you go do the rest of it. It was just super fun, just a bunch of tables with some beautiful bubble solution and crazy strings and ropes and gear to make different kinds of bubbles of different shapes. And I've always been fascinated by that, and that was the kind of, that was the seed that was planted in me, playing with soap bubbles. So yeah, I became an inventor of a toy that uses soap bubbles.
Hey guys, let's have some fun with Family Bubble. Now I know what you're thinking. Indoor bubbles? Don't worry about it. Just throw down a couple of towels. No biggie. Okay, now get your subjects right next to each other. Maybe hugging, maybe like holding hands. More about that later. Also, make sure that you have a dark background behind the bubble, like the TV, under the TV, your clothing, the table. And here's why. Check out the bubble when it has a dark background. Those colors are nice and bright. Check it out. Those colors are popping when they have a dark background. See that? And you can compare that to the places where there's a light background, like the towels or the kitchen floor. See, it's more transparent that way. Now, here we have a big problem. Let me zoom in on this. That's a big problem right there. Look at that kid. See how tempting that is? That is really tempting. You don't know how tempting that is. So next time, maybe she should be like, you know, holding his hand down or something like that. Spread bigger joy, baby.
And that's amazing. And what the toy does, it's a jar that fits in the palm of your hand. And through the use of strings and a little wand, two people can like make a big giant bubble sheet, like a flat sheet of a bed, and lower it like over a kid or three kids or five kids. And you're kind of experience like what it's like to be inside of a giant soap bubble for about 3 seconds, and then it pops.
So you can't suffocate in it or anything like that,
no.
Right?
Okay. No, I get that question. I get that question a lot. A lot of, you know, it's so funny. It's so funny because when I was, as part of my side hustle, I was doing like some bubble parties on the side, and I would say, okay, who wants to be in a bubble? And like all the kids would raise their hand, and then there'd be like one or two kids that look at me like, I'm not getting in that thing. and one kid comes up to me and he's like, can you breathe in that thing? Because, you know, they're smart. These kids, yeah. They don't want to get inside something that they can't breathe in. It's like, yes, you can breathe, and it's going to pop in a matter of about a second.
So they don't want to be a headline.
Right. Right. Exactly. That would be a terrible headline.
A terrible headline with comedic overtones, I would say.
I know. Right.
Getting back into our humor there. But okay, so now, had you ever invented anything else of a comparable nature, or tell me some of your other inventions?
Oh yeah, well, I can tell you that I am not a prolific like inventor of a million different things. I wish I was. Mm-hmm. I'm more of the kind of guy that thinks of something and then obsesses over it for years. Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to be the person who has like idea number 46 and then I'm going to go to market with that. So the last one before this was really my first invention that I called the Grippies. And that was like a little doll that had Velcro hands and Velcro feet and a face that had a little dry erase area on it so that you could like make different expressions and maybe put a little thought bubble or a little voice bubble, and you could like take a picture of it and then change it, make him angry with like angry eyebrows and a frown, and have him say something else. So I toyed around with that idea for a good good couple of years. You know, you learn how to create things. And I love the process of like prototyping and prototyping over again and trying to see how it works. And I sent some out to my friends and we all played with it, you know, but it went nowhere. And I realized it wasn't working. And I just kind of left it on the shelf and moved on with my life and then came up with the bubble toy.
It might be something as simple as the name. The Grippies. It sounds like a fever or something. I have the Grippies.
Right. Maybe that's why it failed.
I think maybe a little relaunch is due here.
No one wants to get a case of the Grippies.
Yeah, exactly. That's so funny,
John. I know I should have come to you years ago. You would have solved everything if I had just talked to you.
Well, you didn't throw it away. It's somewhere, you know.
Right. Can I give you one quote? When I showed my intellectual property lawyer, you know, I was trying to make sure I was securing my intellectual property rights on the Grippies.
Yeah.
When I sent him this video, the response that he had to me on the phone was, "Well, John, I saw your video. It looks like you have a lot of time on your hands."
So, oh my God! That's a skit. Showing you go from office to office to introducing these things to different people and their reactions.
Right. You got a lot. Right. And your lawyer says you got a lot of time on your hands. I was just like, thanks for the compliment.
But, oh my God. You know. But there's the punchline right there. You're a lawyer.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's right. I am. Yeah. Lawyer jokes. But anyways, I think the moral of the story is, and I listen to a lot of interviews with like founders. I'm fascinated by like founder stories. And the thing that I've seen over and over again is that failure is like part of the journey. And if you take failure and you beat yourself up over it, you lose your self-confidence. You just got to take things as a learning opportunity. And that I've definitely learned in this process. One of the founders, the guy who did Coinbase, one of the guys who does Bitcoin, he said that starting a company is like moving from one failure to another with enthusiasm.
Right.
You know,
that's understandable.
One setback to another. Yeah. Yep.
I mean, it's just like the many projects that I've done. This is the one that's going to go syndicated and blah, blah, blah. Like, you know, right. Well, I never made a dime on Wrestling Talk, you know? So
that's,
you know,
a shame, because just... that show was awesome. You and Paul Fay were, you guys were amazing. And I love that show.
And I love it
about
too.
Enthusiasm. You guys had so much enthusiasm. Yeah.
Thank you.
By
John.
The way, a client of mine, a 10-year-old, just told me, I said, what do you do over your break? And he goes, I went to a WWE thing in DC. I was like, oh, I'm so jealous.
Wow.
brings me back to being 14.
WWE ain't what it used to be.
Yes, that's true. That is definitely true.
Story for another show, another series.
Yes.
So yeah, we've got that straight. You're not a professional inventor. You're not putting your whole life on the line, but you periodically come up with these ideas. They percolate maybe for a few years, and then you try to introduce them, and they have, you know, a long line of them, or are those the only two?
Those are the only two, but the Inormo, the bubble one, it's called Inormo. Here's my plug. Yeah, Inormo with an I, like you get into this enormous bubble. Inormo. You can see it at Inormo.com.
I just thought of something, an advertising campaign for you. An animated character named Norm O. And he advertises Inormo.
See, you know, you're just full of ideas.
Yeah, I couldn't invent anything. I couldn't make it work. You're the guy that makes it work.
Yeah, right. Well, this one is going to work. This one's already out there. This one, people are buying it. I'm in pre-sales right now, and my inventory is coming next month. So on Inormo.com, you're going to be able to buy a little jar that has, you put one kid in a bubble, that's called the kid in a bubble. You have a bigger one that's called the family bubble. It's big enough to put your whole family under a bubble.
Wow.
And then the third one's called the solo bubble, and this is one that kids can do all by themselves.
Starts with the weights. Those go in first, okay? Put everything into the solution, the wet part. Get under the suds with all the string, all the way to the tips of the wands. Now keep your hands dry and don't stir it around. You just pull it right out. Let the excess drip in there for a couple of seconds. Then, with the wind at your back, if you have any wind, you start with it closed like that. Then, you slowly open it. The wind is going to blow it outward, not into your body. Then she closes it. She closes it so that there's a bubble that comes out, a free-floating bubble. There it is. If you keep it open, it'll make a big, long snake, and then it'll pop, okay, without any bubbles. Here goes the bubble into the wind. Have some fun, guys. All right, spread bigger joy, baby.
It's the green one, and it has only two wands instead of four, so you're not making a big square. You're opening up two, and you're making a big triangle. And then you open it up and you can make huge bubbles with this triangle, like all by yourself. And there's a little weight at the bottom. So if you can picture a triangle of string that you dip into the solution, and then when you open it up, it's a giant bubble. So,
wow.
So this invention will not be like getting a case of the grippies. This is going to be, this is this one. This is the one, right? You got to have that optimism.
Well, the grippies can be salvaged as a comedy skit. And then with a name change, you never know, this might succeed like a normal.
Exactly. There you go. I love that attitude.
I never throw anything away. That's what I do.
Right.
I never throw an idea away. You know, I don't make inventions, but I make skits. I still make skits, even though I'm not doing them, you know?
Right. Yep. You put them on the shelf, and then one day when you're ready, you get it back off the shelf.
You do. So that's really cool, John. And I'm really glad for you that this is succeeding so far. Now, do you foresee a day, and maybe I'm a little premature, but I'm a dreamer, as you know, maybe you'll introduce this to the people on Shark Tank.
It's really funny you say that, because guess what? Shark Tank came to DC, like, I don't know if it was a year ago or maybe two. They came to DC and they were auditioning. And this was right around the time that I went to New York. I went to the New York Toy Fair at Javits Center in New York, the annual toy fair, you know, the big one. Every year, the new toys are presented, and it's a huge multi-level fair where, you know, you have all these booths and presentations, and it's like the most fun you could ever have. It was, that weekend was like amazing. But what I did was I brought my toy, and it was kind of in prototype form, and I put a bunch of toy industry people inside a giant bubble, each one who came by my booth. Whenever they came by my booth, I said, hey, you want to get in a bubble? And sure. They get in a bubble, and then I'm like, hey, I could email you the photo. So I would get all their emails, send them their photo of them in a bubble, and it was great. But right after that, Shark Tank came by Washington, D.C., and I thought, you know, I could put all four of those guys inside of a giant bubble.
Yeah. That would be awesome.
It would be a great shot, Len. I mean, they would love that shot. Yeah. But, you know, then they would say, well, Mr. Krell, you know, tell me how many units you've already sold.
Yeah.
Zero. Tell me about your plan for your zero.
Well, you know, so wait a while.
I would not have gotten any investments.
Yeah, so bide your time. And right. I think it can happen. I can see it. I think it can happen.
Mark Cuban, he's just crazy enough to buy into this. Mark, if you're listening, that this is, you know, this is your company.
And this is your podcast, again, Mark. Fund really? My podcast.
Yeah, look at Len. Look at Len. Throw some money his way. Throw some money his way too. Why not? Right?
We just have too much fun together, John. After all these years,
it's like no time has passed. You look, it is. You and I both look we look just as young as we did then.
Well, I got a little turkey gizzard here, but you know, that's why I have my lighting right. The way I do.
All right.
Okay, so now let's say best case scenario, Inormo takes off.
Yes.
And do you see yourself inventing anything else?
Well, the cool thing about this product is that the Inormo toy is expandable. And my goal is, yes, that right now it comes with in three different sizes, the ones I told you about, kid, family, and the solo. Mm-hmm. But I've got about seven other types of giant bubble makers that could all come from the same type of jar using the same solution. And it's, they're all compatible with each other. So the answer is I have a lot of ideas for this line of toys, and it's going to be the most fun bubble toy that's like on the market. But as far as like past soap bubbles, the answer is I have no idea.
Right.
Right now, I've got my blinders on. It's all about giant bubbles. I'm trying to democratize giant bubbles so that like everyone can play with them.
What you're doing is very good, because when you concentrate on one thing at a time, things happen. You know,
that's what I'm trying to do.
All your concentration is going into that. So you're not, you know, running around like a chicken with his head cut off, you know?
Right. Right.
With exactly. 50 million ideas. That's really, right. Really awesome. So away from the lawyering and the seriousness of what you do, which is very important to society, and away from the inventing, how else do you unwind, John?
Oh, with my family?
With your family? Too personal for the air.
Oh, yeah. You know, I have these great three kids, and we go and do all kinds of stuff. Marina, my partner, is like the best, most wonderful person in the world and supportive of all this crazy stuff. We spend our time just having as much fun as we possibly can. The whole family is like, let's go do it. And we're constantly on the run to, you know, events and parks and whatever, everything. Of course, for the last 2 years, they've all been outdoors. They've all been masked up and all that. But
yeah,
the beauty of kind of what I see in the last couple of years is, you know, there's so much sadness and there's so much tragedy and there's so much challenge that everyone's going through, that it does make you take a step back and prioritize kind of, you know, what's important to you. And you know, it makes you kind of think about all the things that have bothered you in the past. And it's like, I can't believe now that I used to worry about that stuff. The most important stuff is like love and family and friends and joy. And you got to look for it. You got to capture it. You got to hold on tight to everyone and everything that you love and enjoy it to the fullest. And that's what we do on like a daily basis, whether we're just chilling at the house or out at a park or, you know, going on a hike or just, you know, enjoying a backyard, sprinting around the backyard with the dog and the friends, you know.
That's great. What kind of dog you got?
German Shepherd. I know you love shepherds.
Oh, man.
So I got a German Shepherd named Penny. I'm going to say, I can send you a photo you can use for your B-reel.
Love it.
You know, our dog is part of the family. She features in our videos on Inormo.com. She's the dog that gets like put inside the bubble. She's like looking around. Like, she's like, what is this? What is this? You know,
wow.
So it's all about the joy.
That's amazing. So now I always come to this question by the end of an interview, because of the name of the series, what do you want to do? If there are people out there who want to do what you do, either the career part that we mentioned earlier, the serious lawyering stuff, or being an inventor, what would you advise them to do?
Well, I would have to say that, you know, I'm 51, Len.
No, you're 16. It's aging.
All right, I'll always be 16. I know. but yes, as a 51-year-old, you know, I can safely say that, like, look, whatever your career is, whatever your situation is, in your family, your relationship, your work, or whatever, you know, the things that interest you, the things that like make you, that you're thinking about when you wake up in the morning, when you go to bed at night, and that are interesting you, you know, it's what, where your curiosity takes you, is what you should be doing with at least some of your spare time, to the extent you have any. Some of us don't have any right now. And I've carved out time for my, you know, passions and curiosities. And I would just, I guess my advice to people is, you know, don't be shy and bashful about it. And don't ask for permission about it. You know, sometimes you got to look out for yourself. You got to be your own guardian ad litem, is what we say over at work. You know, you got to be your own advocate. And when you have that kind of curiosity and passion, I think the key is to not worry about the haters, not worry about your family members who say you should don't worry yourself with this. You got to go make money. You got to go do this. You got to go do that. Don't worry about what society says. You got to at least follow that passion a bit, not to the point where you're throwing your life away or you're not able to put food on the table. But, you know, it's about finding balance. And for me, that balance is like, for me, it's the key to my happiness. I'll just speak for myself. When I'm out of balance and I don't have any of that curiosity and passion going on and no side project, and, you know, you're feeling some amount of burnout of work and stress. You know, the thing that helps me with stress management, because there's a lot of stress, is, you know, grabbing on to that passion and that curiosity now and then to give you, you know, recharge your batteries and make it helps you feel great. So I would say, don't be shy.
I like it. It's sound advice. It's great advice. Very positive and very inspiring. And all I have to say is the world of inventing and the world of law, their gain has been comedy's loss. You would have made a hell of a comedian and a hell of an actor.
That's really nice, Len.
It's true.
That's nice. Well, it's very kind. I think if you and Joe Dulett and I were born at a different time, it would have been Spielberg and company with probably Joe being Spielberg, but you know, we've had some fun, definitely.
We got to do what we wanted to do. Name of the show.
Right.
Name of the
show.
I do that joke way too often on this show. I got to stop repeating myself. I cringe when I watch these shows and when I hear myself, oh, I said that last week. Oh, I said that a week before. But anyway, thank you, John, for joining me on What Do You Want to Do? And I hope you'll come back. Every time you have a milestone with Inormo, I want you to come back and tell them, no, seriously, tell me your progress. Because I'm doing that with people.
Will.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So thank you all for joining us, John and I. And until next time, what do you want to do?
That's true. Now, okay, let's describe specifically some of the elements in this film. Now, you have you yourself play a rather insane individual by normal, whatever the definition of that term is, normal people standards. You walk an invisible dog.
Invisible?
Explain that. Yes, invisible dog. Well, I couldn't see him. You could see him.
You couldn't see the dog?
I saw the leash. I heard him. Even felt him a little bit biting me because I used my imagination a little bit.
You couldn't see the dog?
No, I'm sorry. Does this make you sad or?
No, I saw the dog.